Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Journey of the Mountain Man by William W. Johnstone, narrated by J. Rodney Turner. It is only the dead who do not return. Bertrand de Vuzek. 1.
I didn't think you had any living relatives except for your sister.
I didn't either. But then I forgot about Pa's brother. He was supposed to have gotten killed at Chancellorsville back in 63. I guess this letter came from his kids. It would have to be. It's signed Faye Jensen.
I wonder how they knew where to write, Sally asked. Big Rock is not exactly the hub of commerce, culture, and industry.
The man laughed at that. The school teacher and his wife kept coming out in the way she could put words together. It was 1882 in the high up country of Colorado. The cabin had recently been remodeled. Two new rooms added for Lewis Arthur and Denise Nicole Jensen. The twins were approaching their first birthday, and the man called Smoke was torn between going to the aid of a family member he had never seen and staying at home for the birthday party.
You have to go, Smoke. Sally spoke the word softly.
Gibson, in the Montana territory. The tall, wide-shouldered, and lean-hipped man shook his head. A long way from home. On what might be a wild goose hunt. Probably is. I don't even know where Gibson is. Sally once more opened the letter and read it aloud. The handwriting was definitely that of a woman, and a woman who had earned high marks in penmanship.
Dear Cousin Kirby, I read about you in the local paper last year after that dreadful fight at Dead River. I wanted to write you then, but thought my brother and I could handle the situation ourselves. Time has proven me incorrect. We are in the middle of a war here, and our small ranch lies directly between the warring factions. I did not believe when this range war was started that either Mr. Dooley Hanks or Mr. Cord McCorkle would deliberately harm us. But conditions have worsened to the point where I fear for our lives. Any help you could give us would be greatly appreciated. Respectfully, your cousin, Faye Jensen.
Have you ever heard of either of these men, Smoke? McCorkle. He came into that country 20 years or more ago. Started the Circle Double C. He's a hard man, but I never heard of him riding roughshod over a woman.
How about this Dooley Hanks?
Smoke shook his head. The name sort of rings a bell, but it isn't ringing very loud.
When will you be leaving, honey?
He turned his brown eyes on her, eyes that were usually cold and emotionless, except when he looked at her. I haven't said I was going.
I'll be fine, Smoke. We've got some good hands and some good neighbors. You don't have to worry about me or the babies.
She held up the letter.
They're blood kin, honey.
He slowly nodded his head. I'll get things squared away around the sugar loaf and probably pull out in about 3 days. He smiled. If you just insist that I go. She poked him in the ribs and ran laughing out of the room.
That's him.
The little boy said to his friend, visiting from the east.
That's the one everybody writes about in them penny dreadfuls. That's Smoke Jensen.
Smoke tied his horse to the hitch rail in front of the Big Rock Guardian and went inside to speak with Haywood Arden, owner and editor.
He sure is mean-looking, the boy from back east said. And he really does wear them guns all whopper-jawed, don't he?
The first thing Haywood noticed was Smoke wearing two guns. The left-hand 44 worn butt forward for a cross draw. The right-hand 44 low and tied down. Expecting trouble, Smoke? Not around here. Just getting used to wearing them again. I've got to take a trip, Haywood. I don't know how long I'll be gone. Probably most of the spring and part of the summer. I know Sheriff Carson's out of town, so I'd be beholden if you'd ask him to check in with Sally from time to time. I'm not expecting any trouble out there. Preacher Morrow and Bountiful are right over the ridge, and my hands would fight a grizzly with a stick.
I'd just feel better if Monty would drop by now and then. I'll sure do it, Smoke. He had a dozen questions he liked to ask, but in the West, a man's business was his own. Smoke stuck out his hand. See you in a few months, Heywood. Give Dana my best. Heywood watched the tall, broad-shouldered, ruggedly handsome man stroll up the boardwalk toward the general store. Smoke Jensen, the last mountain man, the hero of dozens of dime novels, the fastest gun in the West, a man who never wanted the title of gunfighter, but who at 16 years of age was taken under the tutelage of an old he-coon named Preacher. The old mountain man had taught the boy well, and the boy had grown into one of the most feared and respected men in the West. No one really knew how many outlaws and murderers and gunslingers and highwaymen had fallen under Smoke's thundering 44s. Some said 50, others said 200. Smoke himself didn't really know for sure. But Heywood knew one thing for a fact. If Smoke Jensen had strapped on his guns and was going on a journey, it would darn sure be interesting when he reached his destination. Interesting and deadly. The next morning, Smoke saddled a tough mountain-bred horse named Dagger. The outline of a knife was on the animal's left rump. Checked his canvas and tied down supplies on the pack horse and went back into the cabin. The twins were still sleeping as their father slipped into their rooms and softly kissed each child's cheek. He stepped back out into the main room of the cabin, the den, as Sally called it. Sally, I don't know what I'm riding into this time or how long I'll be gone. She smiled at him. Then I'll see you when you get back. They embraced, kissed, and Smoke stepped out the door, walking to the barn. With the pack horse rope in his left hand, Smoke lifted his right hand in farewell, picked up the reins and pointed Dagger's nose toward the north. Sally watched him until he was out of sight, then with a sigh, turned and walked into the cabin, quietly closing the door behind her. Smoke had dressed warmly, for it was still early spring in the High Lonesome, and the early mornings and nights were cold. But as the sun touched the land with its warming rays, he would shed his heavy lined jacket and travel wearing a buckskin jacket, made for him by the squaws of Indian friends. He traveled following a route that kept the Rocky Mountains to his left and the Medicine Bow Mountains to his right. He crossed the Continental Divide and angled slightly west. He knew this country and loved it. Preacher had first shown this country to him back in the late 60s, and Smoke had fallen in love with it. The Columbine was in early bloom, splashing the countryside in blue and lavender and white and purple. Smoke's father, Emmett Jensen, was buried at Brown's Hole, up near the Utah line in the northwest corner of Colorado. Buried lying atop thousands and thousands of dollars in gold. No one except Smoke and Preacher knew that, and neither one of them had any intention of spreading it about. Old Preacher was in his early 80s, at least, but it had filled Smoke with joy and love to learn that he was still alive. Cantankerous old billy goat. On his third night out, Smoke made camp halfway between Rabbit Ears Pass and Buffalo Pass, in the high-up country of the Rockies. He had caught some trout just before dusk dropped night on the land and was frying them in a dollop of lard when he saw Dagger's ears come up. Smoke set the frying pan away from the flames on a part of the circle of stones around the flames and slipped back a few feet from the fire and put a hand on his Winchester 44.
"Hello, LaFar," the voice came out of the darkness. "I'm friendly as a little wolf cub, but as hungry as a just-woke-up bar."
Smoke smiled, but his hand did not leave his Winchester. "Then come on in. I'll turn no hungry man away from a warm fire and a meal." The stranger came out of the brush, keeping one hand in view, the other hand tugging at the lead rope which was attached to a reluctant donkey.
"I'm a-heading for the trading post on Illinois," he said,
stripping the gear from the donkey's back and hobbling the animal so it could graze and stay close.
"Ran slap out of food yesterday and ain't seen no game at all." I have plenty of fish and fried potatoes and bread, Smoke told him. Spread your blanket and sit.
Smoke poured him a tin cup of coffee.
Kind of you, stranger. Kind. I'm called Bigfoot. He grinned and held up a booted foot. Size 14. Been up in Montana looking for some color. Got snowed in, coldest damn place ever been in my life.
He hooked a piece of bread and went to gnawing.
I run a ranch south of here, the Sugar Loaf. Name's Jensen.
Bigfoot choked on his bread. When he finally got it swallowed, he took a drink of coffee.
Smoke Jensen? He managed to gasp.
Yes.
Aunt Fanny's drawers.
Smoke smiled and slid the skillet back over the flames, dumping in some sliced potatoes and a few bits of some early wild onions for flavor.
Whereabouts in Montana?
All around the Little Belt Mountains, east of the Smith River.
Is that anywhere close to Gibson?
Dern sure is.
And that's a good place to fight shy of, Smoke. Big range war going on, gonna bust wide open any minute.
Seems to me I heard about that. McCorkle and Hanks, right?
Right on the money. Dooley Hanks has done hired Lanny Ball and McCorkle put Jason Bright on the payroll.
I reckon you've heard of them two.
Killers. Two-bit punks who hire their guns.
Bigfoot shook his head.
Hey, you can get away with saying that, but not me. Them two is poison fast, Smoke. They's talk about that Mexican hawk Diego coming in. He's supposed to be bringing in half a dozen with him. Bad ones.
Probably Pablo Gomez is with him. They usually double-team a victim.
Say, you're right, I heard that. They're going to be working for Hanks.
Smoke served up the fish and potatoes and bread, and both men fell to it. When the edges had been taken off their hunger, Smoke asked,
town had to be named for somebody.
Who's Gibson?
Well, there really ain't much of a town. 3-4 stores, 2 saloons, a barbershop, and a smithy. I don't know who Gibson is or was, whatever.
No school?
Well, sort of. Got a real prissy feller teaching there. Say, his name's Jensen, too, Parnell Jensen. But he ain't no kin to you, Smoke. Y'all don't favor at all. Parnell don't look like nothing.
Parnell was his uncle's middle name.
But Parnell's sister now. Brother, that is another story.
Smoke dropped in more lard and more fish and potatoes. He sopped up the grease in his tin plate with a hunk of bread and waited for Bigfoot to continue.
Miss Faye would tackle a puma with a short switch. She ain't no real comely lass, but that ain't what's keeping the bow away. It's that damn temper of hern. Got her a tongue you could use for a skinning knife. I seen and heard her lash out at that poor brother of hern one time that was plumb pitiful. Made my old donkey draw all up. He teaches school and she runs the little ranch they got. Dernest mixed up mess ever did see. That woman rides a straddle. Plumb embarrassing.
Bigfoot ate up everything in sight, then picked up the skillet and sopped it out with a hunk of bread. He poured another cup of coffee and with a sigh of contentment, leaned back and rolled a smoke.
Mighty fine eat, Smoke. Feel human again.
Where are you heading, Bigfoot?
Kansas. I'm giving her up. I've been prowling this countryside for 25 years chasing color. Never found the mother lode. Barely finding enough color to keep body and soul alive. My brother's been pestering me for years to come help work his hog farm. So that's where I'm heading. Me and Lucy over yonder, best burrow I ever had. I'm gonna retire her. Just let her eat and get fat. You?
Heading up to Montana to check out some land.
I don't plan on staying long. You fight Shy Gibson now, Smoke. There's something wrong with that town.
How do you mean that?
Can't hardly put it in words. It's a feel in the air. And the people is crabby. Oh, most go to church and all that, but it's... Well, they don't like each other. Always bickering about this and that and other thing. The lid's gonna blow off that whole county one of these days. It's gonna be unpleasant when it do.
How about the sheriff?
He's near about 100 miles away. I never put eyes on him or any of his deputies. Ain't no town marshal. Just a whole bunch of gun slicks looking hard at one another. When they start grabbing iron, it's gonna be a sight to see.
Bigfoot drank his coffee and lay back with a grunt.
And I'll tell you something else. That Faye Jensen woman, her spread is smack in the middle of it all. She's got the water and the graze and both sides wants it. Sharp tongue and men's breeches and all. I feel sorry for her.
She have hands?
Had a half a dozen. Down to two now. Both of them old men. Hanks and McCorkle keep running off anyone she hires. Either that or just that right killing them.
Drug one young puncher, Hanks's men did. Killed him.
But McCorkle is not a really mean person. He just don't like Hanks. Nothing alike.
Hanks is evil, Smoke. Just plain evil. 2. Come the dawning, Smoke gave Bigfoot enough food to take him to the trading post. They said their goodbyes and each went their own way. One north, one east. Smoke pondered the situation as he rode, trying to work out a plan of action. Since he knew only a smattering of what was going on, he decided to go in unknown and check it out. He took off his pistols and tucked them away in his supplies. He began growing a mustache. Just inside Wyoming, Smoke came up on the camp of half a dozen riders. It took him but one glance to know what they were. Gunhawks.
Light and set,
one offered, his eyes appraising Smoke and deciding he was no danger. He waved toward the fire.
We got beef and beans. Just don't ask where the meat come from,
a young man said with a mean grin.
You talk too much, Royce, another told him. Shut up and eat.
He looked at Smoke. Help yourself, stranger.
Thanks.
Smoke filled the plate and squatted down.
Looking for work. Any of you boys know where they're hiring?
Depends on what kind of work you're looking for, a man with a long scar on the side of his face said.
Punching cows, Smoke told him. Breaking horses, riding fence, whatever it takes to make a dollar.
Smoke had packed away his buckskin jacket and for a dollar had bought a nearly worn-out light jacket from a farmer, frayed at the cuffs and collar. He had deliberately scuffed his boots and dirtied his jeans.
Ain't help you there, the scar-faced man said.
Smoke knew the man, but doubted the man knew him. He had seen him twice before. His name was Lodi, from down Texas way, and the man was rattlesnake quick with a gun.
How come you don't pack no gun? Royce asked.
Smoke had met the type many times, a punk who thought he was bad and liked to push. Royce wore two guns, both tied down low. Fancy guns, engraved .45 caliber peacemakers.
I got my rifle, Smoke told him. She'll bang 17 times.
I mean a short gun, Royce said irritably. One in the saddlebags if I need it. I don't hunt trouble, so I ain't never needed it. One of the other gun hands laughed.
You got your answer, Royce. Now let the man eat.
He cut his eyes to Smoke.
What be your name?
Kirby. He knew his last name would not be asked. It was not a polite question in the West.
You look familiar to me.
I've been working down on the Blue for 3 years, got the urge to drift.
I do know the feeling.
He rose to his boots and started packing his gear. These men, with the possible exception of Royce, were range-wise and had been on the Owl Hoot Trail many times, Smoke concluded. They would eat in one place, then move on several miles before settling in and making camp for the night. Smoke quickly finished his beef and beans and cleaned his plate. They packed up, taking everything but the fire. Lodi lifted his head.
See you, Puncher.
Smoke nodded and watched them ride away, to the north. He stayed by the fire, watching it burn down, then swung back into the saddle and headed out, following their trail for a couple of miles before cutting east. He crossed the North Platte and made camp on the east side of the river. He followed the Platte up to Fort Fred Steele, an army post built in 1868 to protect workers involved in the building of the Union Pacific Railroad. There he had a hot bath in a wooden tub behind a barber shop and resupplied. He stepped into a cafe and enjoyed a meal that he didn't have to cook, and ate quietly, listening to the gossip going on around him. There had been no Indian trouble for some time. The Shoshone and the Arapaho were, for the most part, now settled in at the Wind River Reservation, although every now and then some whiskied-up bucks would go on the prowl. They usually ended up either shot or hanged. Smoke loafed around the fort for a couple of days, giving the gun hands he'd talked with ample time to get gone farther north. And even this far south of the Little Belt Mountains, folks knew about the impending range war. Although Smoke did not hear any talk about anyone here taking sides. He pulled out and headed for Fort Casper, about halfway between Fort Fetterman and Hell's Half Acre. The town of Casper would become reality in a few more years. At Fort Casper, Smoke stayed clear of a group of gunslicks who were resupplying at the general store. He knew several in this bunch. Eddie Hart, Pooch Matthews, Golden. None of them were known for their gentle, loving dispositions. It was at Fort Casper that he met a young, down-at-the-heels puncher with the unlikely handle of Beans. Bainbridge is the name of folks hung on me, Beans explained with a grin. I was about to come to the conclusion that I'd just shoot myself and get it over with, knowing I hadn't to go through the rest of my life with everybody calling me Bainbridge. A camp cook over in the Dakotas started calling me Beans. He didn't have no teeth, and every time he called my name, it come out sounding like Beans Beans. So Beans it is. Beans was one of those types who seemed not to have a care in the world. He had him a good horse, a good pistol, and a good rifle. He was young and full of fire and vinegar. So what was there to worry about? Smoke told him he was drifting on up into Montana. Beans allowed as how that was as good a direction as any to go, so they pulled out before dawn the next day. With his beat-up clothes and his lip concealed behind a mustache, and his hair now badly in need of a trim, Smoke felt that unless he met someone who really knew him, he would not be recognized by any who had only bumped into him casually. "You any good with that shotgun?" Smoke asked. "Man over in Utah didn't think so. Rattled my hock shortly before the funeral." Now there was two ways to take that. Your funeral or his. He was a tad quicker, but he missed. Enough said. On the third night out, Beans finally said what he'd been mulling about all day. "Hey, Kirby, there's something about you that just don't add up." "Oh?" "Yeah. Now, to someone who just happened to glance over at you and ride on, you'd appear to be a drifter. Spend some time on the trail with you and a body gets to thinking." Smoke stirred the beans and laid the bacon in the pan. He poured them both coffee and waited. "You got coins in your pocket and greenbacks in your poke. That saddle don't belong to no bum. That Winchester in your boot didn't come cheap, and both them horses are wearing a brand like I ain't never seen. Is that a circle double snake or what?" "Circle double S." As his spread had grown, Smoke had changed his brand. S for Smoke, S for Sally. It was registered with the brand commission. "There ain't no S in Kirby," Beans noted. "Maybe my last name is Smith." "Ain't but one S there." "You do have a point." Beans was only pointing out things that Smoke was already aware of. "How far into Montana are you planning on going?" "Well," Beans grinned, "I don't know.
Take it along with you, I found that the grub's pretty good. You're aware of the impending range war in Montana? Now, there's another thing that don't ring true, Kirby. Sometimes you talk like a schoolteacher. Now, I know that you don't necessarily mean nothing out here, but it do get folk to thinking. You know what I mean? Smoke nodded and turned to bacon. And them jeans of yours is wore slick on the right side, down low on the leg. You best get you some other britches to strap that hog leg back on. You don't miss much, do you, Beans? My folks died with the fever when I was 8. I've been on my own ever since, going on 19 years. Starting out alone, that young, a body best get savvy quick. My real name is Kirby Beans. All right? You didn't answer my question about whether you knew about the Range War. I heard of it, yeah. But I don't hire my gun. The way I had it figured, with most of the hands fighting, them rich ranchers is gonna need somebody just to look after the cattle. He grinned. That's me. I'd hate to see you get tied up in a range war, Beans, cause sooner or later, you're gonna have to take a stand and grab iron. Yeah, I know. But I don't ever worry about bridges until I come to 'em. Ain't that food about fitting to eat? They were lazy days. And the two men rode easy, no reason to push. Smoke was only a few years older than Beans, chronologically speaking, several lifetimes in experience, and the men became friends as they rode. Spring had hit the high country, and the hills and valleys were blazing in God's colors. The men entered Johnson County in the Wyoming Territory, rode into Buffalo, and decided to hunt up a hot bath. Both were just a bit on the gamey side. After a bath and a change of clothes, Smoke offered to buy the drinks. Beans, with a grin, pointed out the sign on the bathroom wall. Don't forget to write your mother, boys. Whether you're worth it or not, she is thinking of you. Paper and envelopes free. So is the pickled eggs. The whiskey ain't. You got a ma, Kirby? Beans. Everybody has a mother. Smoke grinned at the man. I mean, is she still alive? He flushed red. No. She died when I was just a kid back in Missouri. I thought I smelled a Missouri puke in here. The voice came from behind them. Smoke had not yet tasted his whiskey. He placed the shot glass back on the bar as the sounds of chairs being pushed back reached him. He turned slowly. A bear of a man sat at a table. Even sitting down, he was huge. Little piggy eyes. Mean eyes. Bully was invisibly stamped all over him. His face looked remarkably like a hog. Are you talking to me, pig face? Smoke asked. Big Pig stood up and held open his coat. He was not wearing a gun. Smoke opened his jacket to show that he was not armed. Bean stepped to one side. I think I'll tear your head off, Big Pig snorted. Smoke leaned against the bar. Why? The question seemed to confuse the bully, which came as no surprise to Smoke. Most bullies could not be classified as being anywhere close to mental giants. For fun, Big Pig said. Then he charged Smoke, both big hands balled into fists that looked like hams. Smoke stepped to one side just at the last possible split second, and Big Pig crashed into the bar. His bulk and momentum tore the rickety bar in half and sent Big Pig hurling against the counter. Whiskey bottles and beer mugs and shot glasses were splintered from the impact. The stench of raw whiskey and strong beer filled the smoky barroom. Hollering obscenities and roaring like a grizzly with a sore paw, Big Pig lumbered and stumbled to his feet and swung a big fist that would have busted Smoke's head wide open had it landed. Smoke ducked under the punch and sidestepped. The force of Big Pig's forward motion sent him staggering and slipping across the floor. Smoke picked up a chair, and just as Big Pig turned around,
Smoke splintered the wooden chair across his teeth. Big Pig's boots flew out from under him and he went crashing to the floor, blood spurting from smashed lips and cuts on his face. But Smoke saw that Pig was a hard man to keep down. Getting to his feet a second time, Pig came in a rush, wide open. Smoke had already figured out that the man was no skilled slugger, relying on his enormous strength and his ability to take punches that would have felled a normal man. Smoke hit him flush on the beak with a straight from the shoulder right. The nose busted and the blood flew. Big Pig snorted away the pain and blood and backhanded Smoke, knocking him against the wall. Smoke's mouth filled with the copper taste of blood. Yelling, falsely sensing that victory was his, Pig charged again. Smoke dropped to his knees and drove his right fist straight up into the V of Big Pig's legs. Pig howled in agony and dropped to the floor, both hands cupping his injured parts. Still on his knees, Smoke hit the man on the side of the jaw with everything he could put into the punch. This time, Big Pig toppled over. Down, but still a hell of a long way from being out. Spitting out blood, Smoke got to his feet and backed up, catching his breath, readying himself for the next round that he knew was coming. Big Pig crawled to his feet, glaring at Smoke, but his eyes were filled with doubt. This had never happened to him. He had never lost a fight, not in his entire life. Smoke suddenly jumped at the man, hitting him with both fists, further pulping the man's lips and flattening his snout. Pig swung and Smoke grabbed the thick wrist with both hands and turned and slung the man, spinning Big Pig across the room. Pig crashed into the wall and went right through it, sailing across the warped boardwalk and landing in a horse trough. Smoke stepped through the splintered hole in the wall and walked to the trough. He grabbed Big Pig's head and forced it down into the water, holding him there. Just as it appeared the man would drown, Smoke pulled the head out, pounded it with his fists, then grabbed the man by his hair and, once more, forced the head underwater. Finally, Big Pig's struggling ceased. Smoke wearily hauled him out of the water and left him draped half in, half out of the trough. Big Pig was breathing, but that was about all. Smoke sat down on the edge of the boardwalk and tried to catch his breath. The boardwalk gradually filled with people, all of them staring at awe at Smoke. One man said, "Mister, I don't know who you are, but I'd have bet my spread that you wouldn't have lasted a minute against old Ring, let alone whip him." Smoke rubbed his aching leg. "I'd hate to have to do it again." Bean squatted down beside Smoke. When he spoke, his voice was low. "Kirby, I don't know who you really are, but I sure don't ever want to make you mad." Smoke looked at him. "Hell, I'm not angry." He pointed to the man called Ring. "He's the one who wanted to fight, not me." "Lord have mercy," Bean said. "All this and you wasn't even mad." Ring groaned and heaved himself out of the horse trough. Smoke picked up a broken 2x4 and walked over to where Ring lay on the soaked ground. "Mr. Ring, I want your attention for a moment. If you have any thoughts at all about getting up off that ground and having a go at me, I'm going to bust your head wide open with this 2x4. You understand all that?" Ring rolled over onto his back and grinned up at Smoke. One eye was swollen shut and his nose and lips were a mess. He held up a hand. "How's about you and me being friends? I sure don't want you for an enemy." 3. The three of them pulled out the next morning, Ring riding the biggest mule Smoke had ever seen. "Satan's his name," Ring explained. "Man was going to kill him till I come along. I swapped him a good horse and a gun for him. One thing, boys, don't never get behind him if you got a hostile thought. He'll sense it and kick you clear into Canada. There was no turning Ring back. He had found someone to look up to in Smoke, and Smoke had found a friend for life. "I just can't handle whiskey," Ring said. "I can drink beer all day long and get mellow. One drink of whiskey and I'll turn mean as a snake." "I figured you was just another bully," Bean said. "Oh, no. I love everybody till I get to drinking whiskey. Then I don't even like myself." "No more whiskey for you, Ring," Smoke told him. "Yes, sir, Mr. Kirby, whatever you say is fine with me." They were getting too far east, so when they left Buffalo, they cut west and crossed the Bighorn Mountains, skirting north of Cloud Peak, the 13,000-foot mountain rearing up majestically, snow-capped year-round. Cutting south at Granite Pass, the men turned north, pointing their horses' noses toward Montana Territory. "Mr. Kirby?" Ring asked. "Just Kirby, Ring, please. Just Kirby." "Okay. Kirby, why is it we're going to Montana?" "Seeing the sights, Ring." "Okay. Whatever you say, I ain't got nothing but time." "We might find us a job punching cows," Bean said. "I don't know nothing about cows," Ring admitted. "But I can make a 9-pound hammer sing all day long. I can work the mines or dig a ditch. There ain't a team of horses or mules that I can't handle. But I don't know nothing about cows." "You ever done any smithing?" Smoke asked. "Oh, sure, I'm good with animals. I like animals. I love puppy dogs and kitty cats. I don't like to see people mistreat animals. It makes me mad. When I get mad, I hurt people. I seen a man beating a poor little dog one time back in Kansas when I was passing through driving freight. That man killed that little dog and for no good reason." "What'd you do?" Smoke asked him. "Got down off that wagon and broke his back, left him there and drove on. After I buried the little dog." Bean shuddered. "Dogs and cats and the like can't help being what they are. God made them that way. If God had wanted them different, he'd have made them different. Men can think. I don't know about women, but men can think. Man shouldn't be cruel to animals. It ain't right, and I don't like it." "I've never been mean to a dog in my life," Beans quickly pointed out. "Good. Then you're a nice person. You show me a man who is mean to animals, and I'll show you a low-down person at heart." Smoke agreed with that. "You born out here, Ring?" "No. Born in Pennsylvania. I killed a man there and done time. He was a no-good man, mean-hearted man. He cheated my mother out of her farm through some legal shenanigans. Put her on the road with nothing but clothes on her back. I come home from the mines to visit and found my mother in the poor farm dying. After the funeral, I looked that man up and beat him to death. The judge gave me life in prison." "You get pardoned?" Beans asked. "No. I got tired of it and jerked the bars out of the bricks, tied the guard up, climbed over the walls, and walked away one night." "Your secret is safe with us," Smoke assured him. "I figured it would be." They forded the Yellowstone and were in Montana Territory, but still had a mighty long way to go before they reached Gibson. Smoke and Beans had both figured out that Ring was no great shakes when it came to thinking, but he was an incredibly gentle man, as long as he kept him away from the whiskey. Birds would come to him when he held out his arms. Squirrels would scamper up and take food from his fingers. And he almost cried one day when he shot a deer for food. He left the entrails for the wolves and the coyotes and spent the rest of the journey working on the hide, making them all moccasins and gloves. Ring was truly one of a kind. He stood 6'6" and weighed 300 pounds, very little of it fat. He could read and write only a little, but he said it didn't matter.
He didn't have anyone to write to no ways, and nobody ever wrote to him. At a small village on the boulder, Smoke resupplied and they all had a hot bath. Ring was so big he made the wooden tub look like a bucket. But Smoke had a bad feeling about the village. Not about the village itself, but at what might be coming at them if they stayed. Smoke had played on his hunches before. They had kept him alive more than once. And this one kept nagging at him. After carefully shaving, leaving his mustache intact, he went to his pack horse and took out his 44s, belting them around his lean hips, tying down the right-hand gun. He carefully checked them, wiping them clean with a cloth and checking the loads. He usually kept the chamber under the hammer empty. This time, he loaded them both up full. He stepped out from behind the wooden partition by the wooden tubs and walked into the rear of the store, conscious of the eyes of Beans and Ring on him. They had never seen him wear a short gun, much less two of them, one butt forward for a cross draw. 5 boxes of 44s, Smoke told the clerk.
You plan on starting a war?
The clerk said, taking his mouth into something that didn't concern him. Smoke's only reply was to fix his cold brown eyes on the man and stare at him. The clerk got the message and turned away, a flush on his face. He placed the ammunition on the counter and asked no more questions. Smoke bought 3 cans of peaches and paid for his purchases. He walked out onto the shaded porch, Ring and Beans right behind him. The three of them sat down and opened the peaches with their knives, enjoying a mid-morning sweet syrup snack. Don't see too many people wearing twin guns that way, Beans observed, looking at Smoke's rig. Not too many, Smoke agreed and ate a peach. Riders coming, Ring said quietly. From the south. The men sat on the porch eating peaches and watching the riders come closer. You recognize any of them? Smoke tossed the question out. Beans took it. Nope. You? That one on the right is Park, gunfighter from over in the Dakotas. Man next to him is Tabor, gunhawk from Oklahoma. I don't know the others. They know you? Ring asked. They know of me. Smoke's words were softly spoken. By the name of Kirby? No. The 5 dusty gun hands reined up and dismounted. A ferret-faced young man ducked under the hitch rail and paused by the porch, staring at Smoke. His eyes drifted to Smoke's twin guns. The other gunhawks were older, wiser, and could read sign. They were not being paid to cause trouble in this tiny village. Therefore, they would avoid trouble if at all possible. The kid with the acne-pocked face and the big Colt slung around his hips was not nearly so wise. He deliberately stepped on Smoke's boot as he walked past. Smoke said nothing. The 4 older men stood to one side, watching, keeping their hands away from the butts of their guns. Ferret-Face laughed and looked at his friends, jerking a thumb toward Smoke. They ain't much to him. I wouldn't bet my life on it, Park said softly. To Smoke. Don't I know you? Smoke stood up. At the approach of the men, he had slipped the leather hammer thongs from his guns. We've crossed rails a time or two. If this punk kid's a friend of yours, you might better put a stopper on his mouth before I'm forced to change his diapers. The kid flushed at the insult. He backed up a few yards, his hands hovering over the butts of his fancy guns. They call me Laredo. Maybe you've heard of me. Can't say as I have. Smoke spoke easily. But I'm glad to know you have a name. That's something that everybody should have. You're making fun of me. Am I? Maybe so. I think I'll just carve another notch on my guns. Laredo hissed. Yeah, I had you pegged right then.
a tin horn. Draw, damn ye. But Smoke just stood, smiling at the young man. Two little boys took that time to walk by the store. Perhaps they were planning on spending a penny for some candy. One of them looked at Smoke, jerked a dime novel out of the back of his overalls, and stared at the cover. He mentally shaved off Smoke's mustache. His mouth dropped open.
It's really him. That's Smoke Jensen.
All the steam went out of Laredo. His sigh was audible. He lifted his hands and carefully folded them across his chest, keeping his hands on the outside of his arms. Beans and Ring sat in their chairs and stared at their friend. He's some distance from Colorado, Smoke, Tabor said. And you're a long way from Oklahoma, Smoke countered. For a fact, you heading north or south? North. I never knowed you to hire your guns out. I never have. It isn't for sale this trip either. But you do have a reputation for butting in where you ain't wanted, Park added his opinion. I got a personal invitation to this party, Park. But if you feel like paying the fiddler, you can write your name on my dance card right now. I ain't got nothing again, you Smoke. Not until I find out which side you bucking leastways, McCorkle or Hanks. Neither one. The gunslicks exchanged glances. That don't make no sense, one of the men that Smoke didn't know said. You got a name? Dunlap. Yeah, I heard of you. You killed a couple of Mexican sheep herders and shot one drunk in the back down in Arizona. But I'm not a sheep herder, and I'm not drunk. Dunlap didn't like that, but he had enough sense not to pull iron with Smoke Jensen. He was planning on riding in with nobody knowing who you were, wasn't you? Tabor asked. Yes. Next question is why? I guess that's my business. You're right. I reckon we'll find out when we get to Gibson. Perhaps. He turned to Beans and Ring. Let's ride. After the three men had ridden away toward the north, one of the two gun hands who had not spoken broke his silence. I'm fixing to have me a drink and then I'm riding over to Idaho. It's right pretty this time of year. Laredo, now that Smoke was a good mile away, had reclaimed his nerve. You act like you're yeller, he sneered. But the man just chuckled. Boy, I was over at what they's now calling Telluride some years back when a young man named a Smoke Jensen come riding in. He braced 15 of the saltiest old boys there was at that time. Let's see. That was back in '72, I reckon. He looked directly at Laredo. And you bear in mind, young feller, that he killed about 10 or so getting to that silver camp. He killed all 15 of them so-called fancy gun handlers. Yeah, kid. He's that Smoke Jensen. The last mountain man. Since he killed his first Injun when he was about 15 years old over in Kansas, he's probably killed 100 or more white men, and that's probably figuring low. There ain't nobody ever been as fast as he is. There ain't never gonna be nobody as fast as he is. And I know you couldn't help notice that bear of a man with him, that there's Ring. Ring ain't never followed no man in his life afore today. And that tells me this. Smoke has done whipped him fair and square with his fists, and if I ain't mistaken, that young feller with Smoke and Ring is the one from over in Utah around Moab. Goes by a half dozen different names, but one he favors is Beans. Now, boys, I'm a-fixin' to have me a drink and light a shuck, because wherever Smoke goes, they soon a half a dozen or more of the randiest old boys this side of hell. Smoke draws them like a magnet does steel shavings. I had my say. We part in company. Like as of right now. Down in Cheyenne, two old friends came face to face in a dingy side street barroom. The men whooped and hollered and insulted each other for about 5 minutes before settling down to have a drink and talk about old times. Across the room, A young man stood up, irritation on his face. He said to his companion, I think I'll go over there and tell them old men to shut up. I'm tired of hearing them hoot and holler. Sit down and close your mouth, his friend told him. That's Charlie Star and Pistol LaRue. The young man sat down very quickly. A chill touched him, as if death had brushed his skin. I thought them old men was dead, he managed to croak after slugging back his drink. Well, they ain't, but I got some news that I bet would interest them. I might even get to shake their hands. My daddy just come back from hauling freight down in Colorado. He want to go with me? No, sir. The young man walked over to where the two aging gunfighters were sitting and talking over their beers. Sir? Charlie and Pistol looked up. What can I do for you? LaRue said. The young man swallowed hard. This was real flesh and blood legend he was looking at. These men helped tame the West. You gentlemen are friends with a man called Smoke Jensen, aren't you? You bet your boots, Charlie smiled at him. My daddy just come home from hauling freight down to a place called Big Rock. He spoke with the sheriff, a man called Monty Carson. Smoke's in trouble. He's gone up to some town in Montana Territory called Gibson to help his cousin, a woman. He's going to be facing 40 or 50 gun hands right in the middle of it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.